Not Your Mother's Radio is listener-funded. If you wish to assist and help keep the station active, funds can be sent via PayPal to Elliot.is.not.your.mother@gmail.com. Remember, there is only one L and one T in Elliot. Thank you for your assistance. It is appreciated.
Morgan Fisher is an English keyboard player and composer, and is most known as a member of Mott the Hoople in the early 1970s. However, his career has covered a wide range of musical activities, and he is still active in the music industry. In recent years he has expanded into photography. Fisher has maintained a lifelong interest in photography and in recent years has been holding an increasing number of solo exhibitions of his work in Japan and abroad. He has evolved a technique of abstract photography which he calls light art, influenced by the photograms of Man Ray and others. Not Your Mother's Radio is pleased to have been able to spend some time with Morgan. So let's listen to one of Morgan's solo works and then we will join Morgan and Elliot. Enjoy and stay safe.
Thank you. So yeah, so I saw you play with Mott in the day.
Are we on now?
Yeah,
are we live?
Yeah, this is it. We're just going to we'll just talk a bit and just have some fun. You played at the on Broadway, right? You were in the Broadway band.
You bet. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I saw that show. I saw the Radio City show that year or the year before that.
Right.
And then I saw Mott when Vernon Allen was still there, actually, way back when.
And yeah, I saw them once.
Yeah.
I have to say I wasn't a fan.
They were more like the Rolling Stones back then, right?
Yeah, I mean, they were good. A lot of people prefer the early Mott, and I love it now, but at the time I was into progressive rock.
Yes.
And I had my own band who were like doing quite complicated stuff. But by chance, I saw Mott play once and I thought, well, you know, it's just a good rock band.
Yeah.
So when I joined, I wasn't a fan. I joined because the main reason I joined them was because they were going to America and I'd never been there.
Okay.
I thought, this I want to do.
You never got to America with like the Third Air Band or anything like that?
No. The Third Air Band I only did two shows with. Because then Mott came along, so I thought this is more interesting.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, and my first band, Love Affair, were strictly European success, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So let's get started in the good old days. How did when did you realize that piano, you know, keyboard playing was for you? It was going to become your profession, your love, your whole existence.
Well, you know, like many people, there was a piano in the family house and I banged on it when I was a little boy. And I decided at age 10 to have lessons without being forced to, which is nice because a lot of people were forced. But then what really turned me around was after 4 years of lessons, I heard the Beatles on the radio. Not for the first time. I'd already heard the first two singles, Love, Love Me Do and Please, Please Me. I was not that impressed, but when I heard She Loves You blasting out of my radio at home, I thought, this is what I want to do. I want to be a pop rock musician. So I was 14 then, just good timing. And I quit my lessons and just got totally into learning blues, jazz, rock, just by ear, by listening to records for hours every day. And then 16, I joined a soul band, and then I was off and running.
Okay, and you haven't stopped.
I've had a few breaks.
That's okay.
It was 1980, and what I like to say is I was fortunate enough to live through two golden ages, the 60s and the 70s. And the last real peak for me was the punk rock era, which I loved. And up until then, it had just been just one wonderful new era after another, just so rich. Yes. But after punk rock, music became so corporate somehow and so synthesized and just didn't do it for me at all. And plus the political scene wasn't great in Britain at that time with Margaret Thatcher. Mm-hmm. So I decided to head off and just leave. You know, I've been working 12 years nonstop. So it was time for a real break.
Right. And so you did, you went through, you had that band Morgan, which was a great band.
Yeah, that was long before that. Yeah.
Yeah. And, mm-hmm. You know, and then, you know, obviously the Mott thing. After Mott, British Lions, right?
Yeah.
Mott and British Lions. And that's when John came on board, right?
That's right, John Fiddler.
Yeah, and two albums with them.
In the heat of the summer, gonna
And were you involved with Box of Frogs too?
Not at all. No, that came after British Lions.
Yes, it did. And you weren't. Yeah, you weren't involved in that. Okay.
No, I was off doing my own thing after that.
Yeah. And I spoke. I actually spoke to Trey Gunn this morning.
Oh yeah.
And he did something with Fripp and you on the miniature album.
The second miniatures album.
Yeah. So, okay. So, well, let's get into that. We kind of got the whole background there. And what I like to do is just kind of talk about your solo stuff. Because Mott the Hoople, you did one album with, right?
Well, I did one studio album and one live album.
Yeah.
And some singles.
Yeah. And then you actually were there for the Mick Ronson phase too, right?
I was, which was much too short. It was quite sad how it ended so abruptly.
Yeah. I actually saw, I saw Mott the Hoople and the Hunter Ronson Band in the same year, actually, in New York.
Oh, really? That's quite an achievement.
Yeah. I think actually when Ian Hunter left with Ronson, they had that band put together pretty quick, right?
They did, and he already had plenty of songs, so they went and did an album, well, his first solo album.
Yeah.
Pretty quickly, yeah.
Yeah, yes. And I saw you guys on Broadway, and not long after that, I saw Hunter Ronson at the Felt Forum in New York. Yeah. There was a small theater behind the garden.
And yeah, Mott did that one time with the Dolls.
Yes, I saw that show too.
There you go. You've seen a lot.
Yeah, I did. And that was a great year for music. Bowie was floating around New York a lot, and the Dolls and Mott the Hoople and Mott, and it was a great time for music. Todd Rundgren had his thing going at the time, and it was just a great time to be in New York. So you've worked with the Third Air Band for a short time, Mott, and then you kind of helped out Medicine Head when they reformed.
Yes, I did. They were just doing their last tour of England, and I already knew them for some years, and I'm a big fan. And John needed a keyboard player, so I thought, this is great. I don't have anything else to do. Right. And what a pleasure to play with him. So we did a 2 or 3 week tour of England. Uh-huh. And I played on a few album tracks.
Okay.
Which is their last album, I think.
Yeah, I think so too. And did you hear John's new single? Did you hear his new...
Oh, sure. We keep in touch all the time.
Yeah, it's a great song.
I love it. Yeah, it's called Warriors of Love.
Yeah.
And we made a single together also some months ago.
Really?
Called Forgive and Forget, which I think is on his website.
Okay.
We co-wrote that and recorded it by email,
Yeah, cool. How's the pandemic affecting you? Everybody's locked up, right?
Yeah, they are. I mean, in Japan, the lock up or lockdown is not so stringent. And we have extremely low figures. We're still around 1,600 mortalities, which is pretty low because Japan is one third of the size of America. So the rates are pretty damn low. But I'm being very careful. I am basically staying home.
That's what I'm doing.
Because I'm not as young as I used to be, and I have slight chest problems. So I figured just play it safe,
Yeah.
So basically, I don't go anywhere except by bicycle. Uh-huh. I'm not taking any public transport.
Uh-huh. And you've been in Japan for a long time now.
Just half my life.
Yeah. Wow. And I think we lost more than 1,600 people today in America.
Wow.
Yeah, we started. Terrible. Yeah, the numbers started creeping back up again pretty quickly. I know we're at like almost 220,000.
I know.
Yeah, crazy numbers. But the president has it now, and he'll wake up a bit, but we'll see. We'll see. He's not the sharpest tool in the toolkit.
Yeah, don't get me on that subject. I don't want to alienate some listeners. Okay.
Yeah. Well,
I think America needs a big change.
Yeah. With any luck, we'll have it next month.
Yep. I wish I could vote. I really wish I could vote. But there you are.
I voted today. I got my early vote out today.
Good for you.
Yeah, that's done. I actually, first time I left the house in months, I got my ballot in the mail, And yeah. I just drove down there, put my mask on, and ran in and dropped it in the box and came back home.
Good for you.
Yep.
If anyone hasn't done it yet, go and do it now.
Yeah, get it out there because, you know, things have to change and have to change quick. So Medicine Head, from Medicine Head, we did the mock thing and developed.
Well, we did the British Lion thing from Medicine Head on.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, Medicine Head came after Mott?
Oh, yeah.
Medicine Head. Yeah, no, Medicine Head was after Mott, but I mean, oh, okay. No. Okay, so my thing is wrong. I thought actually Medicine Head was prior to Mott.
No, I think I played with Medicine Head in 76, which is by the time Mott had done our second album. Yeah. And we were already thinking of splitting up, which is why I had time to go and do something else.
Oh, okay.
And then when we decided to carry on as British Lions, which is basically the same band, but we needed a different singer.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought, well, wait a minute, Medicine Head have just ended.
Yeah.
What about John? And everyone in the band said, oh, that's such a great idea.
It was a great idea.
So yeah. I asked him, and, you know, there was this one day where I was around John's house having dinner with him and trying to get a decision from him, and all the rest of the guys are waiting on their phone saying, what did he say? Finally, I could call them and say, he says yes. And they were so happy. And it was, for me, you know, both bands, Mott and British Lions, were really good players. But I think once we got John in, we also had really good songs.
Right.
Really that soulful.
He's a great writer.
Yeah.
Your solo career has been incredible. You're not afraid to take chances. You're not afraid to push the envelope. You've done things from, you know, the two miniature sets where everything was under a minute to, you know, to that whole thing with the hybrid kids. How'd the hybrid kids come about? That's that definitely interesting discs.
Well, I was just, you know, I've been getting into home recording for a while. I had a 4-track recorder and I had other instruments than keyboard. I had bass and I had guitar. I had drum machines and I'm just fooling around and mainly doing wacky stuff just for fun. Because, you know, I've always been into the more eccentric side of music too, like Mothers of Invention and The Residents and things like that. So I just started playing around doing that kind of thing at home. And then I met a company called Cherry Red Records, who are still going. They're the longest indies label in England.
Yeah.
And I told them what I was doing. They said, yeah, why don't you make an album? We'll put it out. And so I did. And the concept of Hybrid Kids was to take a song and give it a diametrically opposite arrangement,
right,
regardless of the genre. So, for example, I took MacArthur Park,
which is a
huge symphonic ballad, and I did it as a two-tone ska song.
Yep.
people loading the dump. Between the party pages and the press, still wants to be good, I'm like a stroking pair of pants. My gosh, the box is melting, it's dark, on a swing tonight, it's blowing down. Someone left the cake out in the rain. I don't think that I can take it, cause it's just a lot of bacon, and I'll never run that road.
Conversely, I took the beat. I took the Sex Pistols Pretty Vacant and did it like a sort of Pinky and Perky cartoon song. Pinky and Perky was some puppet characters here. It's a bit like the Archies or that sort of thing, you know, with sped up voices. You know, so basically, and then I did like, say, You've Lost That Loving Feeling by the Righteous Brothers as if it was done by Suicide.
Right, right.
You know, so it's like hilarious fun, but also creative, working with limited means, but trying to wrench the weirdest sounds out of them I possibly could.
Yeah, but like on MacArthur's Park, you get the little, all the nuances and the you know, just the ska thing. Not only was it a ska style, but you had like the little, you know, just the little, you know, the music that's involved in ska, just the little idiosyncrasies were in there too. You didn't leave anything out. It could have been a special song or a Madness song, actually. Sounded like Madness. And
I love the whole two-tone thing, because I was a ska fan. You know, I was a mod when mods were new. So in 65, I was listening to your actual ska.
Uh-huh.
So 15 years later, like, I knew this. Yeah, I know this music. So. But I like the new kind of harder edge that's been put on it by Two Tone.
Right. Yeah.
So, you know.
Great label. And,
The
old Stiff label was great, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And, I spoke to Dave Robinson last 2 weeks ago, I think it was.
He's a great teller of jokes.
Yeah. Yeah, he's a character.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of fun.
Everybody around that company was a character.
Yeah, yeah.
Nick Lowe.
Yeah, actually, I have Ian Gum coming on with Bob Andrews from the Rumor next week.
Right, nice.
We'll do a roundtable. I live in New Mexico now, from New York originally, and Bob moved to New Mexico. And
cool.
Yeah. So I mean, he's not. Yes, I haven't met him in person yet, because everybody's locked up, but we do something online. Okay, so then you've gone through just so many different kind of genre changes and things. What was your, if you could pick one that you really want people to if somebody was getting into Morgan Fisher now, what album would you tell them to pick up and start studying?
Well, I mean, it's hard to say, because like they say, they're like my children. How do you pick your favorite child? Yeah. At the time I was doing this weird, wacky, wild, punky hybrid kids, I very soon also decided to make an ambient music album called Slow Music,
right,
which is a genre I'd loved. I love what Brian Eno had been doing and so on. And I decided to make an album like that. And it's just been reissued on vinyl. So it's still out there. And a green vinyl, actually. And it was actually made not by me playing keyboards, but I recorded a great saxophone player called Lol Coxhill, who had played with Kevin Ayers, but also had done... Yeah. He was like a hero in the sort of free jazz movement. And I got him into my apartment and recorded him. And then I basically spent 2 weeks looping and processing his recording into an ambient album. And I still have some pride about that particular project. And I never really did anything quite like it since then. I've done other ambient albums, but in the more normal way of playing keyboards. Whereas this one, I spent 2 weeks cutting up tape, basically, and making loops. You know, it was really hands-on.
Yeah, like the old days.
The old days, well, cutting and pasting was real. And and I love how it turned out. So that's one I like to point people at.
Okay, and you did the...
Well, that's when I got to Japan. Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Great album.
Thank you. Yeah, I was invited again by an indie label to make an album on a low budget. I didn't have a home studio at that point, but we found a nice studio and all they could give me was 3 days to do a whole album. So I thought, well, I've always loved Sati and I'm not a classical piano player, so I'm not even going to try and play the pieces perfectly because there's thousands of others who do it way better than me. But I'll just kind of improvise on the main themes. So I picked up the main themes that I liked, about six of them, and just put the score on the piano and kind of glanced at it occasionally while I improvised. Also using some of the ambient techniques like tape delay, like frippatronics, you know, where it's basically early looping. I did some of that. And that's how I got the album done, all done in 3 days.
Yeah, wow. Great. It's a great album. It's just a great album just to kick back to.
Thank you. Thank you.
Jeffries was a great album. That was a little more traditional, right?
Ivory's was done in 72 when I still had my progressive rock band. And it was recorded in Italy, where we were signed to RCA Italy, who, because Italians love progressive rock.
Yeah.
And we got to deal with them. And I'm glad we did, because it was the best studio in Europe at that time. Uh-huh. Most studios in 72 were still 8-track, but this was 16-track. So a lot more scope. Plus, in this studio, many of the major Italian film scores by people like Nino Rota and Ennio Morricone were recorded. And for that purpose, they had a whole warehouse full of really interesting keyboards that some of them I'd only seen in like textbooks about vintage gear. And so I pulled those in and did some stuff. So yeah, Ivory's came out a little bit later as a solo album, and it's still around. I think I'm quite glad that nearly all of my work is still around. I don't mean secondhand, but still available, you know, new.
Yeah. And Cherry Red Records is kind of like Rhino Records. They kind of preserve the old legacy music that, you know, anyway.
Smart that they realize that repackaging albums is way cheaper than recording new albums. If you do a good job on it and people still want to hear the music, why not?
Yeah, that was Rhino's thing too, Rhino Records.
Of course, that was a great label too, yeah. I mean, it's a good way for a label to survive through the decades, you know.
Yes.
Whereas Stiff didn't last long, right?
Yeah.
Did some great stuff for a few years and then that was it.
Yeah, really.
Different ways to be.
Yeah. So how'd you pick Japan of all places to make your home?
Oh, random. Most. Uh-huh. I was living in Hollywood and it didn't suit me. Couldn't quite get the kind of work I wanted. And I thought it's time for a change. And having been all over America several times, I wasn't really interested in trying another American city. So I thought, I need something new, something different. And I literally looked at a big atlas, and I opened the atlas and I looked all over the American page and I thought, nah, I can't find anything there. What's on the next page? And I just literally turned the page and there was Japan.
Okay.
And a light went off in my head just saying, why not? This is like such a good idea. I've always been fascinated by this country, by the food and the art and the culture and everything. And so I went with my English girlfriend and we arrived in nothing. We had like $500 between us, not a word of Japanese, no house, no friends, no job. You know, we just got here.
Yeah.
And it was a great place to start from zero. I felt totally at home. It's odd. I've been to so many countries. When I landed here, I felt completely at home. Maybe I was a Zen monk in a previous life.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't know, but I felt good here. And people were so kind and so helpful.
Yeah.
This stupid foreigner who couldn't say anything more than kimono or sake. And just started building again.
And how are you with the language? You know the language now? You could.
I hope so after all this time.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's funny learning a new language at that stage in your life.
Yes.
I was 35. You know, I picked up a few books. I tried a couple of lessons and I just thought, you know, this way of learning, this book learning doesn't really suit me. And to be frank, it never really did. I didn't learn music that way either. I mean, I had piano lessons for a couple of years, sure. but after that, it was just the way I learned was immersing myself in music every day for hours. And just, it's almost like osmosis. It's like the lazy man's way to study, frankly. But that's how all children learn. Right. You know, you don't give a child a book saying, here, learn English. They just listen all day, every day, and they get it
yep.
with all the complexities. Yep. So basically, that's how I picked up Japanese. And I love the sound of it anyway. Like, right. if I'd been in Germany, it may not have happened. Because I like a language that sounds nice.
Right, right. And
yeah.
You talk about kids learning and stuff. When my daughter was in, kindergarten, she was having a hard time reading. You know, this was, 35 years ago, whatever it was. So I went out and I bought one of those TVs with the SAP, the language thing on the bottom where, the words.
Oh, yeah.
And that's how she learned how to read, watching cartoons and reading the bottom of them.
And, hey, great.
Yeah. And I always thought if I had to learn a language, that's how I would, have to do it at this point because I can't go through books anymore either. And
it's the wrong part of the brain.
Yeah.
And, it's okay when you're learning to operate a computer or something.
Yeah. Let's get to the miniatures sets. Those were brilliant. They were. They're a lot of fun. And how'd that idea come about? And how'd you get? You have 100 people, 100 different acts doing them.
Well, again, it was a similar process. It was sort of accidental because after releasing a couple of Hybrid Kids albums, the Cherry Red boss, who's a really nice guy, said to me, we want to continue releasing your stuff, but why don't you make your own label within Cherry Red to have an identity? We'll still do all the distribution for you and we'll release anything you want. And I thought, well, this is great. I mean, I've never had a record company say, do anything you want.
Sure.
And so I decided on this label called Pipe Records, which again, another accident. I used to smoke a pipe in those days. Yeah. And I sat down, seriously said to myself, right, in the next hour, I'm going to find the name for my label, which is always very difficult. It's like finding a child's name or a band name. And I sat down, lit my pipe up to help me relax. And I looked at the pipe and I went, Pipe Records. That's it. Done. Because pipe is also a musical word. So I thought that'll do me. And it also means communication, sending things via pipe. So there you are. Funny how, I think I've got a bit of a knack. I don't know if you'd call it lateral thinking or whatever, but I've got a bit of a knack for picking up hints that life just gives you all the time. Eno talks about that. It's like the hints floating around in the air all the time. You just got to know how to pick them up. You've got to have an antenna.
Yeah.
So
Keith Richards said that's how he writes songs. They're just floating around. He just grabs them from the air. So
yeah, didn't he dream Satisfaction one night and sang it into a tape recorder?
Yeah. But he said, even now, he said that's, they're just, everything's floating around. You just have to learn how to hear it and see it out there and grab it.
And then you get the royalties. Can't be bad.
Yeah, that's right.
But with miniatures, what I did was, once they gave me this carte blanche, I sat down and started to write a list of people I would like to collaborate with, because I just made 3 albums all alone, which is great. But now I thought, now I want to work with some of the interesting people who are active in London these days. And I started the list and it got longer and longer and longer until there was about 50 people on there. And I thought, well, how can I choose? I mean, I just don't know what to do. And then the lateral thinking kicked in and it's almost like this voice in my head said, well, don't pick one, have them all.
Right.
So my next question to myself was, well, how do you get all of these people on an album? I mean, I can't get them all in one room at the same time. And if I did, it would be chaos.
Yeah.
And the voice answered, no, you get them all on, each doing a track of their own. And it has to be 1 minute long so you can get all 50 onto one LP.
Yeah. Wow.
And there was the idea. And I thought, great. And then in the beginning, I overthought it. I thought, okay, well, how about I ask them to miniaturize an existing piece of music, like take a symphony and do it in 1 minute.
Right.
Something like that.
Yeah.
And that was my initial invitation. But after a while, I felt, you know, don't limit it. Just say, do whatever you want for a minute.
So, let's briefly summarize what we know, shall we? The 50s. The 60s. The 70s. And finally, the 80s. Thank you, and good night.
One, a two, a one, two, three. Come on.
Which I did,
and it's amazing. It's amazing the talent that worked with you. I mean, guys from John Otway to Pete Seeger. You know, you ran the gamut on that one.
Well, Pete Seeger didn't actually join this project. Yeah. He'd already made an album, which is a bit of an inspiration. Uh-huh. In the late 50s, he made an album called The Goofing Off Suite.
Yeah,
which was a similar concept in that he took major works and played them on the banjo.
Okay.
And one in particular I like was Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, you know, the whole, that famous melody. Uh-huh. And he played it on the banjo. So I called up Folkways Records in New York, the legendary Moses Ash,
yeah,
who ran that label, and he answered the phone himself, and I told him about the project, and he said, well, you got any money? I said, well, not much. He said, well, how about $100? I said, yeah, I can manage that. So I bought the right to that track just mm-hmm. for my own use for $100. And I thought, you know what? This guy knows how to do business fast. No mm-hmm. wonder Folkways has 2,000 albums on the catalog.
Wow.
So, yeah. But yeah, it came together like that. So Pete Seeger was actually one of the inspirations. And therefore, I thought he needs to be the closing track on the album.
Cool.
Such an uplifting song anyway.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Low Coxhill, who you spoke about earlier, Kevin Coyne's on it. Well, you know who's on it, but, you know, so Andy Partridge. I mean, it's amazing that these people actually did, you know, listen and did their thing under a minute. And it's really, really an entertaining album. So
I think people like the project, you know, because it's an interesting brief to be given, even though there was not a penny exchange because I had no budget.
Right.
But people like the project, and eventually it snowballed. So after I had got like 10 good people on board, I would mention that in the next invitation, and people say, "Oh, he's on there? Okay, I'll join in too."
Yeah.
So it was a snowball effect. And so it came together very easily. Well, a lot of work. I mean, it was writing letters, no email in those days.
Yeah, yeah.
Writing letters, put them in an envelope, buying a stamp.
Yeah. Well, that's how I'm suckering people. I mean, getting people on my show.
There you go.
Same way, the snowball effect.
Right.
Yeah, so you definitely got your music down. And who are you listening to these days?
I've just got an album by Mann.
Well, yeah.
The Welsh band. You remember them?
Sure.
Yeah, with Dick Leonard on guitar.
Yeah, is that the new one? Is that a new
one? No, it's old. It's really old. It's called Maximum Darkness. And actually, I was encouraged to buy it because Dick Leonard is probably the funniest writer about rock music in the world. He wrote at least three books about his band, and they're just drop-dead hilarious. I mean, every page makes you laugh out loud. Yeah. I really recommend his books. And, of course, I like the band's music as well, but the reason someone told me I should buy this album is because the sleeve notes he wrote on it are hilarious, his books.
Yeah,
the problem was, I bought the album on vinyl.
Oh, okay.
And there's no sleeve notes on there. Obviously, the sleeve notes were written for the CD reissue.
Oh, really?
So I got to get that now as well. But still, I've got the album, and vinyl sounds better anyway.
Yeah. So you did that last tour with Mott the Hoople.
Yeah.
Which I had friends who saw it at the Beacon Theater, and they said it was amazing that you guys just pulled all the stops out. And I'm sorry that I would have liked to try to get to see it on the West Coast, but you weren't able to do it. Any chance of putting that back together again if things settle in?
Well, I think there might be. I'm not going to promise anything, but one reason why we had to cancel the West Coast tour last year was that Ian developed tinnitus, and it was quite serious. And so he just couldn't perform anymore. And we've actually spoken recently. We had a Zoom chat a couple of months ago, and he said it's not cured yet, but it's certainly more manageable than it was.
Okay.
I'm not sure what he's doing about that. He said there's actually some certain special earphones that help to mask the noise of tinnitus.
Oh, really?
And basically he's saying, it's frustrating because other than that, he's extremely healthy.
Yeah.
He still does a 5-mile walk every day that he's done for decades, which is why he's in such amazing shape for 81.
Yeah.
And he wants to work again, basically, he says. So that's very encouraging to me.
Yeah, that'd be great. I would love to see. I love to see Mott the Hoople again. And
I think the tour got us our best reviews of our entire career.
Yeah,
last year's tour. I mean, the Variety magazine review was incredible.
Yeah.
It's like something like at last, rock and roll has been properly resurrected.
Yeah.
I thought, well, thank you very much. Because for us, it was like falling off a log. It was just Let's just slip back into the old songs and see if we can beef them up a bit more now, which we could, because there was 8 of us on stage, whereas there used to be only 5.
Right.
So the songs actually sounded better than they used to, I reckon.
Cool. Do you remember who opened the show on Broadway?
On Broadway, a little band called Queen.
Yeah, a little band called Queen. That was their first New York tour, right?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, they did their first UK tour and first US tour opening for us.
Yeah. Yeah, it was quite a show. It really was.
A long, long time ago, I can still remember how that music used to make me smile. We knew if we got a chance that we could make the people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February made us shiver with every paper we delivered, bad news on the doorstep. I couldn't face one more step. Oh, I can't remember if I cried when they told me about his willow bride. But something touched me here inside the day. The music died. Or did it? Ladies and gentlemen, it's the golden age of rock and roll.
Okay, so let's leave the music world a little, and you're actually a photographer.
Well, as well, yeah. I mean, I'm not a photographer in the normal sense of I do great portraits or anything.
No.
But I never was into it that way. I mean, I've been playing with cameras since I was a little boy. But I always got into, early on, I always got into things like nature, you know, flowers, butterflies. Uh-huh. Things like that, just pure colour. So in a way, I was always kind of leaning towards abstract art, which I've always liked. So now my favourite kind of photography I call light painting or light art. And it's basically opening the shutter and moving the camera around. Mm-hmm. So that whatever you see in front of you becomes like a paintbrush. Right. And I make an abstract art using a camera. Yeah, which is a lot easier and cleaner than using paint.
And you also have a lot of shows, right? You've done a lot of showings.
I've done some, yeah, mostly in Japan. I did one in California, Carmel, and one in England. But yeah, I like to do shows. Obviously, that's the best way to share photography. But I also like to, because these things being kind of colourful and abstract, I like to project them when I perform.
Uh-huh.
Especially because my solo concerts often have the same kind of improvising feel about them.
Right.
So they get together very well. And I really look forward to doing more of them once things get safe again.
Yeah.
And where I'm sitting right now in my home studio, this is actually it used to be a piano school, this room. And so I can get an audience of up to about 40 people in here.
Oh, wow.
So before Corona, I was doing monthly concerts here. And people really liked it, I think, to be in the intimate surroundings of someone's home studio and watch them play. So I want to get back into that as soon as I possibly can.
So is that the 100 concert, the 100 month concert?
Yes, an English friend of mine opened a club here called Super Deluxe.
Uh-huh.
And he's an architect and a very modern go-ahead architect. And he wanted to make a modern go-ahead club where cutting-edge bands could do their thing. So he opened this club, and it was a nice, big, spacious club, which most are not in Japan, being such a crowded city. A lot of clubs are like little black holes in the ground, whereas his was a big open space. Mm-hmm. And I thought, I really like to play here. And I did. I played there once, and I loved it. And I said, could I do a monthly show here? And he said, yes, of course. And I just kept going and going and going. Eventually, I did it for 10 years.
Wow.
And decided when you came to the 100th show that I would end the series there on a good number. And then later I restarted doing it here in my home studio.
Wow.
And so I called that show Morgan's Organ.
Yeah, yeah. Is anybody else using your studio? Are you recording anybody? I mean, not now, obviously. But,
not really. I mean, it's not really set up for that. It's a very personal studio. I've had the occasional singer come by and make a demo or something.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really set up for my own use.
Okay, cool. And, you know, again, your stuff is great. So what's your next release going to be? Are you working on stuff now since you're locked up?
Well, what I'm doing, and probably many musicians doing things like this, I've been going through my archives of... Yeah. Various demos, outtakes, unreleased material. And I remember that about 20 years ago, I suddenly had a splurge of songwriting, and I wrote an album's worth of material and recorded it with me singing. And these are proper songs, rock songs. And I played everything on the album. And I never managed to get someone interested enough to release it at that point. And I'm beginning to feel that it deserves to see the light of day. So I'm now talking to a new indies label about that, and they're interested. So
wow.
I won't give you any titles yet because I haven't got the album title yet. But look forward, hopefully, in the next few months to some of that coming out. Maybe not an album right away, just one song at a time.
Uh-huh.
Kind of in a new internet way of doing that. Well, not so new now, but...
Yeah, yeah.
We've been talking about doing it like that, put one song out at a time, and then later put the whole album out. So that's looking like it's on the cards. You know, I think I've got to get one thing off the desk at a time. So once that goes out, I'll think if I want to do another new project. But the other thing is, those 100 Morgan's Organ concerts have all been recorded properly. So I want to get those out now, which is a lot of material, but why not? Because it's just sitting there. And I'm thinking Bandcamp would probably be the ideal vehicle for that.
Yeah, yep.
And put it out there, real low price, and people can pay a bit more if they want. So you can pick up a whole album for $4 or $5
uh-huh.
or more if you like. And I like it because it's I don't hear a lot of people doing it. You know, pure improvisation on interesting vintage analog keyboards.
Yeah.
You know, I have quite a collection. So I'd pick three or four and take them to the club every month, a different set of keyboards, and challenge myself to see what I could do with them. Looping was a big part of it. And so I like that material. I think it has a freshness to it, and I'd like it to be available anyway.
Well, that sounds pretty cool. I do a Sunday night and a Monday night show that's predominantly new music and everything. I would love to be able to play some of your stuff if when you're ready. It would be great.
Absolutely. It won't be long, but I mean, if you want to hear part of it now, I have a SoundCloud page.
Cool. I'll get over there.
Just look for my name there, and there's several examples of it on there.
Cool.
And the Inside Sati album is also on there in its entirety, folks.
Yeah, I have that album. That's not the entire album.
Yeah, well, thank you. Well, that's another one that's had a recent vinyl reissue.
Uh-huh.
So I'm slowly picking up those old albums. People are asking me to, you know, have them reissue it. And I always work with them on the album cover and sleeve notes.
I'll run through some of my favorites. I love I'll Give You My Heart. That was on the Kerry Red single thing. It was a single.
I'm just trying to think if I remember that.
I'll Give You My Heart. I'll Give You My Heart.
I can't remember that.
That was you solo. It's under Morgan. Oh, wait, you know what? I'm an idiot. The name of the song is Genève.
Oh, that one. That's a John Otway song.
Yeah, yeah. The name of the album is I'll Give You My Heart. It's a Cherry Red single compilation album.
Oh, yeah, right. Gotcha. Yeah. And yes, also, that was...
You also did Roll Away the Stone on that, too.
I did it as a pseudo 78 RPM.
That's right.
Vintage orchestral recording.
Yep, yep, yep. And and Sleeper, which is about
from
a
Sleeper Waits.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I love Ivories. I love Inside Satie. And, you know, the Hybrid Kids. Claws is a great album. And
I love that album. I'm proud of that. It's yeah. I call it Let's Put the X Back into Christmas.
Yeah.
Xmas.
Yeah. And I really like the Nova Solis album,
which was the first Morgan Band album. And the singer, Tim, the singer, came from a band called Smile, who turned into Queen.
Yeah, Smile became Queen.
So I knew Queen before they were Queen.
Yep, yep. And you have to keep pumping this music out. It's just some incredible, incredible pieces here. You're a great keyboard player. And I'd love to see some of your art one day. Maybe we could do this again and you could have some art ready too.
Well, I have an art website as well, you know.
Yes, yes, I know. I've checked out
it's, the website. It's Morgan Fisher Art, all one word.
Okay, and if anybody... And if anybody wants to purchase your music now, what's the best place to do that?
Purchase my music? Well, I don't have my own label or Bandcamp set up yet. That's coming. But, you know, basically Amazon,
other
places like that. Yeah.
Okay. And some of your stuff can be streamed. Not everything, but there is a lot of stuff on Spotify.
Yeah, well, I know Cherry Red have put everything that they released up there.
Yep. You don't have any. I'm sorry, but do you have a compilation? Any compilation boxes or anything?
No, I don't. We did talk about that, and finally, me and Cherry Red, for example, just decided, well, let's at least reissue the albums, make sure they're available as new albums. So, like the two Hybrid Kids album and the Miniatures album, two Miniatures album. Were reissued on CD this year.
Mm-hmm.
So they're still available. Slow Music came out as a vinyl album. So all the music from that brief and very creative two-year period in England is now available.
Cool.
I'd like to make a box set, but, you know, it costs money. And we decided let's just stick to simple reissues.
And another very interesting album of yours was Echoes of Lenin.
Yeah, that was done in 1990, 10 years after his death.
Yeah.
As a kind of celebration. I watched the movie Imagine, which had just came out then, and I was very touched by it, and I thought I should do an album covering his songs. And at that point, I was into kind of ambient keyboard style.
Yeah.
So I just thought, well, let's pick... He wrote great love songs.
Yes.
Let's pick the 10 best or 12 best of those and cover them.
Yeah.
And then I thought, while we were finishing up the album, I thought, yeah, it'd be nice to get Yoko on here somehow. And they said, oh, yeah, our company president is a friend of hers.
Uh-huh.
This was a Japanese, quite big label. And so he called her up. She said, yeah, sure, I'll be in Tokyo next month. Let's do it. So she recorded the lyrics of the song Love.
Uh-huh.
And it was a really nice experience, which I just... posted about on Facebook, as it happened. Yeah. Anyway, she was great, very accommodating. I recorded her in a hotel room, which is much more intimate than a studio.
Yes.
And she read the lyrics of Love and told us stories about John.
Yeah.
So she's on the album.
Yeah, today's his birthday. A lot of big celebrations going on today.
And she must be feeling quite sad, I should think.
Yes, well, her son's birthday is today too.
That's right. Oh, well, that helps.
In fact, Gem Records put out a celebration album today. Reworkings of his songs. That's pretty interesting.
I'll look it up.
Oh, and you spoke to my buddy, Tom Guerra.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, I mean, I spoke to Tom, but you've worked with him.
I've played on 3 of his albums, I think, yes. Now.
All of the Above, Trampling Out the Vintage, and American Garden.
There you go.
Yeah.
He's a good man.
He's a great guy, isn't he? That's why that was my Box of Frogs reference, because he actually did a lot of writing for the Yardbirds when they were supposed to go back out again.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. That's why I thought you might have been involved in that, because I know John was. And, John did a lot of work with Tom, too. Tom's a great player, isn't he?
Oh, yeah. He's very solid. Yeah. He's very, very all-round. I mean, player, songwriter, singer, arranger. Yeah. He does the whole thing.
Yeah, and he collects vintage guitars. He's a vintage collector as well.
Well, it's what we do.
Yeah. He told me, I spoke to him just the other night, he has a 1963 Strat that belonged to Howling Wolf.
Jesus, that must be worth millions.
Yeah, he...
How'd he get that?
He bought the guitar and it had a little decal of a cat on it.
Oh.
He traced it back with that decal to the person. He went to the person he bought it from and said, do you know anything about the cat? And the guy said, well, I bought it from this guy. And he followed the, he just kept backing it. Finally, he met this older guy who said, yeah, I bought this guitar from Howling Wolf. And then he started doing research on Wolf, and he saw Wolf playing that guitar. He has photos of that guitar with Wolf.
Okay, so it's time for a Howling Wolf covers album.
Yeah.
I would be there like a shot.
I know.
I mean, when I heard Smokestack Lightning for the first time, I was shaken to the core.
I know.
That voice.
What do you think? I ask everybody this question when I get a little friendlier with them. Muddy Waters or Howling Wolf?
Oh, boy. Well, I have to say probably Howling, because he really shakes you deeply. I mean, Muddy is very cool and very sexy.
Yeah.
But Howling is like deep, deep, deep.
Yeah, the wolf was the man, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, that's... How about keyboard players? Who are your, who were some of your go-to guys?
Well, it's funny. I was just saying to someone today, I was listening to John Lennon's Isolation.
Uh-huh.
And the piano on that is incredible. Yeah. First of all, the chords are very unusual. And then that slow pace that he plays at is so expressive. I mean, he had very limited technique.
Right.
But what he did with it was extraordinary.
Yeah.
And that really impressed me. I'd forgotten how good he was at simple but effective piano playing.
Yeah, that was his quote. Yeah. He said, hey, I'm a musician. Give me a tuba and I'll get something out of it.
There you go. Well, that's true. And I mean, to me, that's really what music's all about, rather than playing a million notes a second, But I mean, who else? Booker T, who was, again, simple but incredibly melodic. Billy Preston, him too. I mean, he really could make an organ sing.
Yeah.
Billy Preston, who I met, actually. He came to England to play with the Beatles for the first time in 69, I think. Well, no, it would be earlier than that, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But he played with the Beatles. And
on the rooftop.
Yeah, and I met him in a bar. Him and George were in a bar, and I didn't even recognize him at first.
Yeah.
And so I got to meet Billy, and I just said, that song of the old Billy's Bag changed my life. I just thought, you can do that with a Hammond organ?
Wow.
Let me try. So I tried, but I couldn't do it. Not like he did.
Yeah. Well, and...
let's say Dr. John. There's another brilliant...
Yeah.
All feel, all juicy.
Yeah. And how about the Longhair, Professor Longhair?
Well, yeah, but he's more, he's fitting into a genre. He created one genre and stayed in it, and that's cool.
Yeah, yeah.
He was a pioneer, but then Dr. John took it further out, I think.
Yeah, yeah. I love Longhair. I think Elvis Presley owes a lot to him. Not the piano, but the voice.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I kind of hooked Elvis up to Longhair just through that whole voice thing. He, you know, that like baritone type thing, this smoothness of it. He was pretty.
Well, when you mention Presley, you know, it takes me back to, you know, just until just before I joined Mott the Hoople. Like a lot of British people, we had a lot of pride. So, and I think justifiably, because we had the Beatles, the Stones, the Who, the Kinks, etc., etc., Pink Floyd, you know, just on and on and on, all these great bands. And, you know, even Jimi Hendrix came to London to make his fortune with two English guys. And we liked, well, I'll talk personally, but I think a lot of people felt this way. We liked some American music, but for us, some of it was a bit like a caricature. So Elvis was this guy in a movie, you know, who we saw him in movies. And then the Beach Boys were like cute guys with white striped shirts on, doing surf music. Although, of course, Good Vibrations was like unbelievable. But there were less US bands that really turned us on, because there was such a richness of our homegrown stuff.
Oh, yeah.
But
you had guys, you had Eric Clapton, you had Peter Green, you had Gary Moore, you had some killers.
I know. But the thing is, when I got to America, finally, with Mott the Hoople in 73, I realized that American music is that way for a certain reason, because America is that way. And it is a very different country to England.
Yeah.
We just happen to speak the same language almost. And just seeing streets full of Cadillacs with fins and diners, you know, and hot dog stands.
Yep.
I loved it, the whole thing. I just thought, what a great country this is. It's so colorful and alive. Then I started to understand why the music came out like that. Yeah. That it's not like a joke, because it almost felt like, because now England came out of the war battle torn, you know, it was ruined and it was gray and grimy and, you know, rough, and we had to rebuild from that. And that's what gave bands like The Who this, their really raw, angry sound.
Yeah.
Which we weren't getting from America. But when I got there, I realized why. Because America had not been through that tragedy. They'd been in the war, but America as a country was not physically attacked, apart from Pearl Harbor. So, you know, I love the vitality of the American society.
Yes.
And then started to realize, you know, this is why people, amazing people like Little Richard appeared. It could never happen in England.
Yeah.
So, you know, I really started to learn to love American music. And then, of course, just about that time, all kinds of the great new stuff started happening, like the New York Dolls and Talking Heads and Joe Walsh and Barnstorm and just some Todd Rundgren, just great bands.
I'll tell you a great Mott the Hoople story. This was before you were there.
Yeah.
This was the old Mott. You know the band Sha-na-na?
Oh, we played with them. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, you played with them.
We gigged with them. I think we did a couple of TV shows with them, and I got to know a couple of them, especially the guy with the bass voice.
Yeah, but you didn't play the Fillmore with them, did you?
I don't think so, no.
No,
I can't remember
where
we played.
It was years and years before you were in the band. I think Vernon was still in the band. Anyway, Sha-na-na opened for Mott. And Mott was, you know, they were packing up, you know, they were getting into the dressing rooms, and they see all these guys who look like, you know, gangsters, look like, you know, something out of a West Side Story. And they thought it was real. They were afraid to walk by them. And I understand that Ian Hunter and Mick Ralphs had to be escorted to the stage because they're afraid they're going to get cut by the guys in Sha-na-na.
That's funny.
Anyway, I know the guy who did the pig light show, you know, the psychedelic lighting. And he grabbed the guys and he said, "Hey, what's wrong?" And they said, "Well, there's a, like a gang down there, you know?" And they said, "Nah, that's Sha-na-na. They're the nicest guys in the world." And by the end of the night, they were sitting there and like, you know, just like, you know, swigging down beers together and everything. He's joking around. But at first, Mott was afraid to walk by them. They thought they were a real gang from the streets of New York.
That's funny. Yeah, I never had that impression. I mean, they look really cool with all the hair greased back, you know.
Yeah.
And all the clothes and everything. But I got to know some of them quite well in a short time, particularly the guy, I'm sorry, I've forgotten his name, but the guy who had the bass voice, you know, boom, 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 skinny guy.
Yeah, Bowser.
Bowser, that's it.
Bowser, yeah.
Well, he turned out to be, off stage when he didn't have any grease in his hair, he turned out to be kind of almost an academic guy, like a young professor or something. Very intelligent, very smart.
I saw Sean and I used to run a club in New York called My Father's Place. They used to come through a lot, but I actually saw Sean Anar open up for John Lennon. Lennon did a show at Madison Square Garden, and the opening acts were Sean Anar, Stevie Wonder, and Roberta Flack.
Yeah, what a lineup.
Yeah, it was a benefit show, and I think that was Lennon's last really big live concert thing.
And yeah, famous, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Boy, yeah, he's the only Beatle I never saw, unfortunately, and he's my favorite.
Yeah, no, I saw him twice. I saw him jam with the Mothers of Invention one night.
Wow.
And
Frank didn't like it at all, I think.
No, him and Frank didn't get along, I understand.
Yeah.
I actually know a lot of the Mothers. I've interviewed a lot of them, and I've worked with a lot of them over the years. And yeah, they didn't get along too well, but I saw George Harrison twice at Bangladesh, and I saw him at a concert when he toured the States as a solo act. And, you know, Ringo is still playing, and I saw McCartney a handful of times.
But, right.
How did you see Harrison?
Like I said, I ran into him in a bar.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I never saw him play.
Oh, you never saw him play. Okay.
I never saw any of them play.
Oh, okay.
I saw Ringo in the Apple office when I was there for a meeting.
Yeah.
I saw Paul at a Beach Boys concert in the audience. And then I ran into George in a bar called the Speakeasy in London, which was like the after-hours bar for rock musicians.
Yeah, you want to hear? I got a great Speakeasy story. Do you remember the Turtles?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, the Turtles, they fly to England, and they're picked up by Graham Nash. Graham Nash takes him back to his home, and he has the an acetate of Sgt. Pepper. It was coming out that week, and the guys are sitting around smoking, you know, weed and just, you know, listening to the album. And he said, "Let's go to this club. I know this great club." And he takes him to the Speakeasy, and the Beatles are there, and McCartney's laying under a table with a camera. Taking pictures of girls' underwear.
Cool.
And Lennon, you know, Lennon's being Lennon, and the Turtles sit down, and Lennon rips apart the Turtles' lead guitar player. He says, "You call yourself a musician? You know, the stuff you do is terrible." Anyway, the guy got so freaked out that he quit the band that night and flew back to the States.
Oh, poor guy.
Wait, it gets better. It gets better.
All right.
Brian Jones the Moody Blues walk in, and you know, Justin Hayward walks in, and he's talking to the Turtles, and he says to them, we just did an album with the Symphony Orchestra. And Mark Volman, the heavyset guy with the curly hair that was in the Turtles, says, let me know how that works out, okay? Anyway, it turned out to be, you know, Nights in White Satin, you know, Days of Future Past. It gets better. Brian Jones walks in with Jimi Hendrix. And Hendrix was just about getting ready to come back to the States to do Monterey. And so he calls over Howard Kalin, and he says to him, "Can you sit down with me? I just want to talk to you a little." So he says, "Yeah, sure, no problem." So they grab a table, and they're sitting there, and Jimmy's asking him what it's like to be a rock star and how do they think you should break into the American market. And they're talking, and while they're talking, they're eating breakfast. You know, it's middle of the night, early morning, and Jimmy orders a bottle of cognac, and they're drinking cognac and eating eggs and everything, and they're all done, and Howard stands up to leave, and Jimmy gets up to leave, and they hug each other, and as they hug each other, Howard Kalin pukes all over him. And Jimmy starts yelling at him, "This is my best velvet suit. What are you doing to me?" It was like, yeah, so that was that was their night at the speakeasy.
Howard and Mark were pretty wild and crazy guys, right?
Yeah, they were.
And they ended up as mothers, too.
Yes, I worked with Flo and Eddie.
Flo and Eddie, which are fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, I must have gone to the speakeasy for about a whole decade. And I think almost the last time I went would have been about 78. And, of course, punk was happening by then.
Right.
And I'd already seen the Pistols down there and people. And I came into the bar and Sid Vicious was holding court there. Well, I wouldn't say holding court. What he was doing, he was standing by the bar. He'd pick a girl, he'd scream at her, grab her by the collar and say, "Buy me a drink!" Actually, buy me an effing drink at the top of his voice.
Yeah.
And she would quake in horror and run to the bar and buy him a drink. And I watched this for a while. Sid was just playing the part, Sid Vicious, you know.
Yeah.
And everyone was egging him on, you know. So I said hello to him and said my name and whatever. And he said, "Well, what instrument do you play then?" And I said, "Piano." And he said, "Well, that's not very bloody violent, is it?" And I said, "You haven't heard me play, son."
There you go. Well,
there you go.
Yeah, he, you know Joe Wobble, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, he Sid gave him his name.
Yes, I believe I heard that.
He couldn't pronounce his name. You know, I think his name was, what, John Wardle or something?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
he seemed like nearly everybody around was called John. I think Sid Vicious was actually John.
Yeah.
A lot of Johns around at that point.
Yeah. So I'm speaking to some guys that you may know, actually. David Jackson from Van de Graaff.
Haven't met the Van de Graaffs, unfortunately. I've seen them.
Yeah. I'll be speaking to them next week.
Great band.
Yeah, they were a great band. And
there's another great keyboard player, yeah.
Yeah, and I spoke to John Altman last week.
John Altman, yeah, he goes back. We go back to when I was doing sessions with Neil Innes from the Bonzos and Ruffles.
Yeah.
And Neil Innes had a TV show called The Innes Book of Records, as opposed to Guinness.
Yeah.
And it was quite a show, and it ran for several months. And he had to come up with 6 or 7 new songs every week for that show. And each song was a different genre, and it had a video to go with it. God knows how they put it all together so fast. Wow. But I was called upon by him every week to go and play on some of these songs. And John was usually there doing the arrangements, especially the brass and strings. Yeah.
Yeah, John is what a talent he is.
Oh, he's so prolific. Amazing. Yeah.
And Dennis, I spoke to Dennis McKay, the producer.
Who did he produce?
He did Ronson's albums.
He's American, is he?
No, he's British. He's living here now, though. He's British.
Oh, sorry. I don't know that.
Yeah, he did. Dennis McKay, he did... He worked for Queen. He worked tons and tons of just about everybody.
And, okay.
He did the Ronson thing. He did some Bowie work, Iggy Pop, just about everybody.
And, oh, great.
Yeah, he did the engineering for Lou Reed, Transformer.
Uh-huh.
And I think he did all the Young Dudes.
Well, I wasn't with them then, so
I know.
I
think he actually did all the Young Dudes.
Oh, well, I guess we just missed each other by a hair.
Yeah, by a hair. So how did the two Mott the Hoople bands, obviously they weren't, you know, the same band other than the core members when you went out again the last time, but was it easier the second time out?
No, not really.
I mean, the first time you guys looked like you were having a lot of fun.
You mean with Ian Hunter? Are you talking about...
Yeah, the 72 band.
Wait a minute, are you trying to compare Mott with Ian and Mott without Ian?
No, Mott with Ian, Mott with Ian part one and Mott with Ian part two.
Oh, I see. Well, of course, I wasn't with Mott part one.
No, I'm talking about when you guys went out just, you know, a year or two ago.
I see.
72.
Oh, I see. So Mott in the 70s and Mott in the 20s. Yeah. Really. Oh, well, of course, being nearly 70 years old and being in your early 20s, there's a bit of a difference there.
Yeah.
Especially capacity for drinking, which I still like a drink, but nothing like I used to. But, you know, it was remarkably similar. I mean, I really put it down to muscle memory, that the songs are embedded in my fingers permanently, and I just had to point my hands at the keyboard and off they went, and they knew what to do.
Now, did Blue Weaver tour with you guys the first time out?
Yes, he did, yeah. He joined us for the Broadway tour. Yeah. And I knew him from way back before then, because I was in Love Affair and he was in Amen Corner. Uh-huh. And we were rivals in the late 60s. But, you know, playing last year with Mott 74, as we called it, was just a delight. I mean, it was like falling off a log.
Yeah,
it happened so naturally. We just fit it into place, and the guys, the members of the Ramp Band who were playing with us, were incredible, because they weren't around in the early Mott days, so they had to actually do work and learn songs, you know.
Yeah,
whereas I just knew them all. Right. But it was a great combination, and it was really, the performance was what it was all about.
Right.
Whereas in the old days, the performance was, of course, important. But then there were the parties.
Yeah.
Parties, and then the shopping and going to thrift stores to buy old guitars and things. And that was like a whole day of like wild stuff, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas now it's like you do the gig and then might just have something to eat and go back to your hotel.
Yeah. And you guys sounded great. Yeah, I saw some stuff online. Luther sounded great, you sounded great, that band was great.
We had a great drummer, Steve Holly from Wings.
Yeah. And excellent. I think, and the Rant Band, I think, behind you just kind of gave you a little extra muscle.
Well, if I had any doubt about doing this, was that Mott the Hoople's original bass player and drummer had passed on.
Yes.
And for me, they still remain the best rhythm section I ever played with. And I thought, well, how's it going to be, you know? But very quickly, as soon as I got in the rehearsal studio with these guys, I thought, oh, we're in good hands here.
Yeah.
And they were so powerful, so solid, and simple as well, you know?
Yeah. And you guys put on a great show. I mean, from what I saw, is there going to be anything coming out, an album or anything?
Well, there's nothing recorded yet. I mean, I think one of the shows have been probably
the live set, you know, from the old live set.
Well, I mean, one of the shows was properly recorded, I believe,
and
even videoed, but there's been no talk of a release yet.
Yeah.
So I think, I don't know, you know, if there's a demand for it, maybe. I'm just more interested in getting back out on the road with them again, because it's such a shame that we missed the West Coast. A lot of people are disappointed by that. And also, my dream is to have them come play in Japan, which is now my home.
Right.
And there's a million Mott the Hoople fans here.
Yeah.
And also to do Australia and New Zealand, who are really up for it as well.
Well, you really have plans.
Well, I mean, I have dreams. Let's put it that way. But, you know, I think we have professional help to try and put those things together. So it's all about when this hellish pandemic gets out of here and lets us go back to living again.
Right. And I know you had like maybe a handful of dates on the West Coast. Do you think, I know, this is just, thoughts. Would you be adding any more dates to it if you would do anything?
It's all a question of demand. And seeing as how the East Coast tour went so well, I mean, it's pretty much sold out everywhere.
Yeah.
And there's just, like I said, there's a whole slew of excellent reviews that bodes well for another tour, you know.
Yeah.
If we show the promoters what we pulled off last year, we may get even more offers, but that's what it's down to in the end, is if the promoters think they can fill the halls, then we'll do more. We're up for it.
So
certainly up for it.
So wasn't the band's idea to cut the I mean, you know, to have just a handful of tours. You're just waiting for more dates to be added.
Well, I think it was a realistic way to get back into the water, as it were.
Okay.
That, you know, to do like a modest number of gigs first and then see how it went.
Right.
You know, and you know, we're not up for doing 3 month tours like we used to.
No, no.
You can do that in your 20s. But I know we're all up for doing whatever we're invited to do, I'm sure.
Cool. Yeah, I used to run stadiums and arenas and stuff. So, you know, I was at a lot too, you know, and it does get to you after a while. I had to leave that world. I have, you know, some chest problems as well. So, So, I mean, I know it gets tough as you kind of get a little older. You have to slow
down. And also, you know, I mean, the really big gigs are not so much fun at all. Because comparing what I did with Mott and then when I toured with Queen, the Queen gigs weren't so much fun. The audience is so far away.
Right.
You can't even see the front row. And so to us, you know, Mott the Hoople, when we were touring, was the ideal size from about 2,000 to 5,000 people.
Yeah.
The
Beacon is perfect for that band.
That's not even 2,000. I think it's like 1,600 or something.
Yeah, it's a beautiful.
But gigs like that, I mean, the front row, some of the people in the front row have actually got their elbows on the stage, right. Which you're that close, you can go shake their hand and wink at the girls, you know.
Yeah, so
to me, that's a proper gig. And there's enough people in the place to raise the roof. Make a noise.
Yeah.
But when it gets to, you've got a 50-yard gap between you and the front row, that ain't no fun.
Yeah, I think one of the best shows I ever saw was the Radio City show that you did. That's the one the Dolls opened, right?
I don't know if they did that one. Probably, because they did most of our New York gigs.
Yeah, I think they opened.
They did the Felt Forum, that's for sure.
Yeah.
You might be right.
Yeah, they didn't do Radio City. It was the Felt Forum, I think. But I don't know if you remember, Radio City started at midnight.
Well, what I do remember is we did a rehearsal and they had the front section of the stage could be lowered into the orchestra pit.
Yes.
So we thought, well, that's a good way to start the show. Me and the drummer will come on and make some noise.
Right.
And then the three front guys will rise up out of the ground and start playing. And we did a rehearsal and it was perfect. And the guy, the stage manager, said, "Don't worry, boys. There won't be any mistake. We'll get it right, and it'll be fine." So, great. So then we go and have supper. We come back, and I get on stage, and the drummer gets on stage, and we start to make a noise, and nothing happens. And we keep making a noise for 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, and the guys don't arrive. It's like the longest 3 minutes of my life.
That's like a Spinal Tap.
exactly. Yeah. Finally, they appeared, but so much for the stage manager.
Yeah.
What's with all his pride?
Yeah. What's he doing today?
I don't know. Sleeping on the job.
So those were great shows. I remember those shows.
Well, I documented some of that tour, you know, with my little 8mm movie camera.
Uh-huh.
I was shooting the band not on stage but off stage.
Yeah.
And I made a DVD out of it.
Yeah, wow.
Which is quite a fun watch. It's called Mott in America.
Yeah, and those are crazy days. A lot of partying going on, a lot of craziness.
Yeah, we were teaching other bands how to party. I mean, the parties were always in our hotel room. Uh-huh. And bands like Queen or Aerosmith would come and party in our rooms.
Yeah, there you go.
So their rooms didn't get smashed up.
Yeah, and you guys were main man artists too then, right? Main man had the...
Only briefly when Ronson was with us, I think. Oh, no, maybe early on when they did Dudes. But only very briefly.
Because I actually saw Bowie at Radio City at midnight as well. I think that was the main man thing, that all the other acts started at midnight for some reason. Yeah, I don't know why, but...
Well, it's because you have subways that run all night. You couldn't do that here or London.
Yeah, I know. And you couldn't do that in a lot of places in America, too.
Right. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah. Those are good old days. So I told you we'd be on for over an hour. We're almost at 90 minutes.
There we are, yeah. Well, So time flies and we've hardly scratched the surface.
Yeah, I know. Are we going to do this? Are we doing this again, or do we have to do another an hour and a half now?
Let's do it later.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay, we'll set up another date,
and definitely with John as well.
Yeah, well, I'll get John on too. So, we just have to figure out the logistics. He's in England, and you're in Japan, and I'm here. So,
one of us is going to have to get up in the middle of the night.
I'll do it.
And it ain't going to be me.
No, I'll do it for you two guys.
What a trooper!
Yeah, I'll do it for you. It's definitely worth it. And I want to thank you. I'll send you a copy of all this, and I'm going to edit some music into the mix and everything else. And man, I had a great time with you tonight, Morgan.
You're very welcome this morning.
And, yeah, that's right. And so anyway, I'll be in touch in a couple of days, and I'll talk to John, and we'll make it happen.
Well, pleasure talking to you, Elliot.
Okay, my friend. Stay safe, okay?
You too. Rock on.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
This is the end of this episode of Not Your Mother's Radio. Morgan and Elliot will be getting together real soon to continue the conversations. Enjoy and stay safe.
Not Your Mother's Radio is listener funded. If you wish to assist and help keep the station active, funds can be sent via PayPal to Elliot.is.not.your.mother@gmail.com. Remember, there is only one L and one T in Elliot. Thank you for your assistance. It is appreciated.